So now to the main part. I'm not going to like Sven after this conversation either way, whether he convinces me to buy one or not.
I wouldn't convince you to buy this one. It's a fine machine. I like it. It does what it's supposed to do. I wanted it largely because it's the Copilot plus PC, and they took away one of the major things of that, but that's okay.
Yeah. So you got the higher end Microsoft Surface Pro.
Yeah.
The X Elite, right?
Yeah. I wanted the higher end processor that came with other stuff that was higher end. Yeah. So I'm on it now. That's what I'm doing this podcast on.
Yeah. And your microphone, is a microphone your headset? Because is it still loaded properly?
I could try the headset, but then you'll get a lot of other stuff probably. These are Beats. Beats Pros.
Okay.
These things that I stuck in. I have other options if you want to try something else.
I was just wondering if that was the internal mic or something else. But okay, now I know.
No, it is Beats.
Okay.
In my ears. So that's it. I did put a couple of things in the show notes. I just for whatever this thing is 2 pounds, 11.2 ounces. The MacBook Air is 2 pounds, 11.1 ounces. I've got one over here, so I weighed them. Weight wise, not much difference. Yeah. Significant difference, form factor, of course. This is a slightly smaller screen than an Air. It's interesting, I think, that Microsoft compares this thing to the Air, not any Pros, and that's probably valid. This is not a high-end PC. You're not going to do architecture.
Although it's not cheap.
No, it's not cheap, but then, MacBook Air isn't cheap either.
Yeah.
This is even less cheap when you discover that it doesn't come with a keyboard. But I'll defend Microsoft on that. You can buy a cheap keyboard for it, or you can buy a medium expense keyboard, or you can buy the high-end keyboard for it. So you have choices, colors, and with the Air, what you got is what you got.
Right.
Can't really change out the keyboard. let's see what else I say here. You asked about heat. I have not.
Yeah.
I have not heard the fans coming on. And I assume there are fans in it. It's like lower end Pro or lower end surfaces don't have little bezels on them. Little places where you can see heat would come out. This one does, of course. So they're expecting it to push heat out. But I have not heard fans turn on.
Yeah. Have you tried anything like processing video from your DJI camera or anything?
I have not tried. I have not. So I haven't done anything super
intensive.
On it. The only thing I have done, I do use Access. That's one of the things I was concerned about. Access is not one of the programs that Microsoft has decided we're going to make an ARM version of.
Yeah.
I got a little nervous at first, but I fired it, loaded my Office products from my Office account. 365 account, my Microsoft 365 account, actually. It didn't load Access, it just loaded the standard 3. And I said, let me go out to Microsoft and go find it and load it. And I couldn't find it. But I noticed that since I use OneDrive, my Access stuff is on OneDrive. It sat there, it had the right icon in it. So I clicked it and said, hang on a second while we install Access.
Hmm.
And it did, and it's there, and it's fine. I did the same with Publisher, so it works fine with it. And I even have a little Access program. One of the things it does, I do some Girl Scout stuff, and they have these things where they go from station to station and do events. And I wrote a little routine to randomize that. I've got a dozen troops and 7 events. I want them to go to events and not see the same troop twice. So I just a little randomized thing like that. And I ran that, and I was impressed by how quickly it did it. I've had some where, a regular PC would take a little while to do it. But
I
fairly quickly.
I haven't been able to get a definitive, well, I shouldn't say I haven't been able. I'm not sure I have a definitive answer on whether Microsoft Office has been ported to ARM. I think the answer is no, but do you know for
yes,
sure?
Yes, the three, Word, PowerPoint, Excel are definitely ARM
okay, programs. But not Access and Publisher.
Some of the other, not Access, Publisher, Visio, you know, Project,
yeah,
stuff like that.
Yeah, and so, those aren't included in the non-enterprise Microsoft Office anyway. So, Visio and
Visio.
Project.
Yeah. Access is on the
record. Access is right, and Publisher. Okay, because and the reason I should say, and this is kind of embarrassing for Microsoft, I think. So I went to Microsoft Copilot, you know, the service, not the PC, and I said, I asked, you know, has Microsoft Office been recompiled or ported to work on the Microsoft Copilot Plus PC running, you know, Qualcomm Snapdragon processors? And it gave me a commercial about, you know, how great the Copilot Plus PC is, but didn't answer my question.
Yeah, I had a similar thing.
Yeah, so it doesn't know about its own products. And when I went to Google Gemini, it said that none of them had been ported, so neither of them gave me a correct answer.
I had a similar experience. It decided it wanted me to use Outlook instead of Mail. So it, you know, I clicked the Mail icon and Outlook pops up, and they've taken away the little switch on Outlook to do it, to put it back. You now have to dig through the settings to get Mail back. So I said, and I saw that pop up once, just once, and I forgot where it was. So I went to Copilot and said, how do I, you know, get out of Outlook and back to Mail? Oh, she was mealy-mouthed on that. I just did not want to tell me how to do that. So I had to use something like Wiki.
Yeah, one of the downsides of alleged AI, right?
It depends on who trains it. They serve their masters.
my other question was, which I see your answers in, but you know, just to get in the discussion, Surface Pen is and so that was that. Yeah, so how do you like it? How is it basically the same as previous?
Before? Yeah, well, it's a carpenter's pencil.
Mm-hmm.
It's pretty nice. I mean, I don't know what it would be like for an artist or a budding artist. I have used
it. It feels comfortable
It feels comfortable. It's a flat carpenter's pencil.
Right, carpenter's pencil. Yeah.
So it's pretty nice. It's got, you know, some features. You can click the back of it and have three different things happen depending whether you click double click or click and hold. So you can set it up to, you know, just click hold it back down and it brings up the screenshot stuff. So then you can use the panda selector area. So stuff like that. And I have used it a couple of times. Yeah, go ahead.
Is the tip really firm, like an Apple Pencil tip, or is it one of those soft?
It's translucent, it's a little softer than an Apple Pencil.
Okay.
It's a little softer than an Apple Pencil, I think. I don't know. I expect there's people that provide extra
ones. Oh yeah, you can buy I had a before I retired, for several years I had a series of Surface Pro 4s because they all broke on me. I had three Surface Pro 4s, all of which self-destructed, and it finally, after the third one died, all under warranty I should say, when the third one died, I said I never want to see another Surface on my desk again. And so I got a nice Lenovo, which was an ugly tank, but it was solid and didn't explode on me. So, you know, non-exploding PCs are good. And by explode, I don't mean boom. I mean, you know, the battery bloat and system board and frog, those kind of things. Yeah. I mean, because there have been exploding PCs, but it's not one of those. So, the one thing I did use it for was that clicker on the top, I think you mentioned.
Yeah,
I set it to advance PowerPoint slides. I think I had it click to advance PowerPoint slides and maybe click to go back or something. That was really handy and people were impressed. that my pen could do that. Yeah. And you said you bought a flex keyboard. What's a flex keyboard? I don't. What's the alternative to a flex keyboard?
Well, Microsoft's got three different keyboards. Any of the old ones. Hang on a second here.
All right.
Any of the old keyboards, ones that have storage, like this is my eight. It has storage for it. But the new Flex keyboard is one you can actually take off the Surface and use it. It's Bluetooth between them.
So it doesn't have to be connected magnetically like the other keyboard.
Doesn't have to be connected yet. Yep.
Yeah, got it.
So you can pull it off. Which I think one thing for art type stuff that I think would be useful is you can lay the Surface almost flat, lay it down to a very shallow angle. And if you're drawing on it and this keyboard's in front of it, it kind of gets in the way.
Oh, definitely.
So you can pull the keyboard off and set it on the side, use your pen to draw. And if you need to do something on the keyboard on the touchpad, you should go to the side and do it.
Yeah.
So I think that's pretty useful. I think a lot of people would just connect a Bluetooth keyboard to it.
Yeah.
If they were going to do that sort of thing. And not even bother the Surface.
I should ask John if he's, I think I asked him before and he was kind of curious, but if he's curious at all about these Microsoft, because you've been pretty much all Mac for a while now.
Yeah,
I know you had a Surface at work.
I bounced back and forth because I did like my Surface at work, and there I do run a Windows virtual machine on my Mac because there are times I just need Windows for something. But the problem is the things I need Windows for, I don't know if they would run on ARM because they tend to be very old software anyway. It's a certain utility I need or a driver or something that just... You know, I've got to pull up that virtual machine because, you know, in some cases I have to pull up a Windows 7 virtual machine. Some of that stuff I don't think is going to run anymore. That's the only thing that kind of keeps me off. And plus, right now with my MacBook being an Intel 2020 MacBook, I'm really interested in thinking about getting an Air and maybe getting an Air for my wife as well. So if I'm looking at buying one or two MacBook Airs over the next year, I don't know if I have the time to really play. I have a budget. I just don't know if I have the time to play with multiple devices. I don't want something just sitting here that I don't end up using.
Yeah.
I already have those. They're called Raspberry Pis.
I have my Raspberry Pi 5 in, as you might know. And boy, that thing is impressive. It is so much faster than even overclocked 4. But at any rate, okay, so I'm looking. I know, and Sven, you did a little use the what's the painting thing called, the co-creator or something?
Well, co-create and paint. Co-create and paint. And you can look it on the
I'll put those in our show notes. I mean, our blog.
It's that child's drawing on the one where I've got the entire screenshot there. That's
right.
Me. And then the thing on the right is what it did with it. And I think it did a pretty nice job, actually.
Yeah.
So that's just plain old Microsoft Paint. And you click the co-create button and it puts the little thing off on the side and you can slide back and forth. They showed that, with an actual artist drawing something sort of, and it did a better job than, but it had something
better too. I'm impressed by what it took. Your drawing, which is actually pretty good all by itself, and it really added some more realistic details. I mean, it's still artsy. It's not a photorealistic.
It's not
image.
Oh, it wasn't what intended to be, and that's not even an option really. You can select what kind of drawing you want with anime or oil paint or watercolor or something like that.
Right.
Photorealistic is one of the options.
Yes. So, I think Google may have turned that off too on theirs because, people are doing so many things. I'll put that in our blog. I wish I knew how to cast photos onto our recording here. That'd be interesting, but I just don't know how to do it. Okay, so the next question I have is, how does the keyboard feel? I mean, I know it's one of three, but the one you got.
Yeah, it feels fine to me. I always have to caveat that with I'm not a touch typist. I hunt and peck. or the Eagle method, I say, circle three times and swoop. So it does feel fine to me. It doesn't. They said that they made this one a little stiffer than the other ones, and I may agree with that. It does, like the other ones, give you a little lift. It folds up against the front of the tablet itself, so there's a little bit of an angle. I don't think it's as much as an angle as the other keyboard, but the other keyboard also hides the pen when you fold it up. This one, the pen is right in front of me. And for one of the next things, I'll show you what it looks like when we get down to it. But the keyboard feels fine to me. I do think the Air is the Mac keyboard's better, but
yeah,
you know, it's just a reasonably good keyboard, I think.
Okay, I've become very fussy about keyboards in the last couple of years.
Yeah, and keep in mind, if you wanted this thing, you could buy the tablet and not buy any keyboard. Put whatever keyboard you want and attach it to it.
Right,
it just becomes important.
Although the keyboard is also its cover, its screen cover, right?
So yes, it is.
It does have,
so you know, if you
other buy value,
a $129 keyboard that they make that doesn't have the pen holder or anything in it, you could use that as the portable keyboard and cover, and then just, you know, whatever Bluetooth, Logic Tech, whatever keyboard you want, use it.
Okay. So separate questions about hardware and software compatibility. So we'll start with hardware. So printers, yes. Any problems with drivers or anything
that? I have not. I've got, you know, a good number of printers in the house, mostly Dells and Epsons, getting rid of them, mostly HPs, but they're all in the network, and I had no problem finding any of them.
Got it. Okay.
So,
So they just work. Nothing special.
Yeah, they just seem. Yeah. I went into printers to find my printers and found them.
Okay.
So go ahead. No problem with that.
Any issues with USB drives, thumb drives, SSDs, anything like
that? I thought I had one when you asked that question. I went and grabbed SanDisk thing. I plugged it in.
Yeah.
Saw nothing. Absolutely nothing. Didn't even exist. I heard it go ding when I plugged it in. Nothing. So I took the same drive over to my desktop PC, plugged it in, I got a ding, nothing. And I said,
oh, so it's just bad.
No, this sucker's formatted for my Apple.
Oh.
So it doesn't see it well. So I grabbed another drive and it had no problem with it. So I was a little, oh my God, I might be able to.
Right. One of the drawbacks
of any of these things is it's got two USB-C ports and that's all it's got on it. So,
yeah. Need a hub.
Peripherals.
Yeah. I've gotten a whole bunch of hubs I've been playing with over the last year, especially. But I was going to say, you know, for drives, I've been formatting using EXFAT, instead of the proprietary, you know, the NTFS for Windows or I forget what the Mac OS proprietaries are, the Linux formats essentially. Just so I can move back and forth.
Yeah, well, this one I kind of got it as a what's Apple's Time Machine sort of thing.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I kind of bought it for that. So that's, I let it format it for that. So that's probably why I can't see it too well.
You know, speaking of, I mean, not exactly Time Machine, but you know, one of the downsides of the Copilot plus AI PCs for me personally is the one feature I actually wanted.
Yeah.
Recall
was
pulled because of so many privacy concerns and stuff. It actually has less appeal to me right now than it did a week ago.
Yeah, the co-create kind of stuff is kind of interesting. I've opened it up on pictures. I haven't done it. I've only had this thing for a couple of days. So. I have to work for a living so I can afford this stuff. So not like you retired guys. The other thing you asked about an external webcam. I got a Logitech Stream Cam that I just unplugged from my other machine and plugged into this and popped it up. No issues whatsoever.
And which camera are you using right now for this podcast? Are you using the built-in
camera? This is the built-in camera. And the built-in camera software also has a lot of features on it that that are different. It's got to apply visual effects within the operating system. So with this camera, so the blur is because of
Is it possible for you to go into the whatchamacallit, the mic? We're using Google Meet, the Google Meet microphone option at the bottom, and let us hear what the built-in Surface microphone sounds like.
Yeah, sure. I should be able to do that.
Okay.
It's
on the little microphone in the middle.
Okay, okay. That's should be.
Oh, you actually sound better.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Actually sounds better than the Beats. Way better.
Okay. Well, I'll leave it this way then. I'm just using the Beats to hear so that it's not blasting around.
Yeah. Yeah, I have the other thing I've got AirPods Pro to hear, but I'm using a Yeti Nano to, you know, actually talk.
The other thing that is kind of interesting here is Microsoft has this PhoneLink thing that used to be your phone,
right?
That works with Androids. One of the things they do is let you use the camera on the phone. So I actually have that set up.
Just like a Mac.
And let's see if, kind of like a Mac. So let me see if I can do this for you here.
Oh, here we go.
Go ahead and tap the camera. And now that's from my mode. That's on my Pixel 8.
Yeah.
So I can switch to the back camera on the Pixel 8. And now, now you are looking at you.
Yep.
So, that's not the greatest.
No,
that really isn't very good. But yeah, I'm not sure why. I know the Pixel 8 camera. Yeah, it was pretty good.
Oh, maybe because you've got background blur on. So if it sees a human head, it's kind of happy. Like right now, it's pretty happy.
Oh yeah, let's do the background. Let's turn that blur off. Let's see if that's the wrong one. Okay, the blur's off.
Okay. Oh yeah, now it's clear.
So now that's what the keyboard looks like, and the pen is right at the top here.
Yeah.
So it's always there. It's very, very convenient to get to.
And that's a 13-inch display, right?
It is a 13, and Air is a 13 and a half.
Yeah.
I did measure those this morning. So that's what it looks like. So that's actually works fairly decent. Or switch to front camera there. And there I am on the Pixel 8. It's just off the side to me. I could actually.
It's fun.
That was a kind of a neat thing. There's less you can do, believe it or not, with PhoneLink. With a Pixel than you can do with any Samsung. I don't know what they're in bed together somehow.
Oh. Can we go? Yeah.
Let me put together this back on the front here. So Surface camera front.
It's pretty interesting.
So that's kind of neat. So if I've got somewhere else, I can, you know, actually have the front camera of the Surface, the back camera of the Surface, the front of the back camera of the phone. And if I plugged one in, I got I got five cameras I could switch between.
I gotta say, by the way, I'm really impressed by the microphone on the Surface. It's a lot. I mean, not only is it better than the Beats, I mean, like a lot better, but it is just better than I expected, period. Because most, like my Apple, my MacBook Pro microphone on the webcam is you know, at best, which is why I use an external mic. So I'm really impressed by that.
Well, it does. When I select it, it says microphone array Qualcomm Axtic ACX static endpoint audio device.
Nice.
It's supposed to be a pretty good mic.
If I were using that, I wouldn't even bother to use an external mic. I mentioned I hate you, right, Sven? I've mentioned this before, I think. So let's not.
Well, you know. So I don't know how well it does some of the filtering stuff. Like if I put a background on here, let's take this thing.
Right.
Okay. So
Is that a Copilot feature or is that a Google Meet feature you're using right now?
No, this is actually a Copilot feature or a Windows feature. I'm not sure which, but it's just, I can do this. If I just bring up the camera app, I can pull this up and do that. So it's got the filters and it, I don't know how, you know, it seems to catch pretty well. Not too much.
It looks good.
Aliasing on the side. So
no, it looks pretty good. One of the things we got to try one of these days to see how well it does with translation, you know, so we'll have you and me and Jack Cook and we'll try Bostonian and Hawaiian Pigeon.
There you go. Let's go here.
Hobbit Town.
Yeah. There's a whole bunch of options here.
Yeah. So we talked a little bit about the software option. I mean, not software options, software compatibilities in Microsoft Office, Word, Excel, PowerPoint. All ARM native.
Native ARM. Yeah.
And the rest are presumably not running on Prism.
Well, yeah, it's certainly, you know, Microsoft stuff, but, you know, the people are building stuff for it and they have for a while because it's, you know, they 10X Surface X, whatever that was.
Yeah.
You know, that started out their ARM stuff. So people have been, you know, porting stuff to it, Adobe and various people.
Right.
I looked it up. I did find you can, if you go into a task manager, you can find a place where it will tell you what it's running, but it has to be running. So you have to have it and run it, and you can look and see if it's ARM or x64, x86 emulation. So you can't find out which one it's doing.
So this is like a Windows 11 for ARM feature or something else?
No, it's Task Manager. In Task Manager.
Oh, just Task Manager. Okay, got it.
Yeah,
got
it's
it.
Just, there's a column in there that says...
Interesting.
Something. I don't remember what it says anymore.
Okay.
But there is a place that actually lists how it's running.
And I should note,
vast majority of the stuff I see, you know, you open up Task Manager on a Windows machine, there's 800 tasks running.
Right.
So, and the vast majority of things are ARM. And only when I start something like Access, I can go dig for that.
And sort, I should note
sort
that
by that column.
My hesitancy to go to this platform, aside from paying all that money, is I had... Not only have I had horrible, horrible experiences with the Surface Pro, Intel version, but I also had the misfortune of buying the Surface RT in 2012. And I really thought that was going to be a kind of like a, you know, post-netbook, pre-Chromebook. I forget when the Chromebook came out. But anyway, it seemed like a good alternative for me, and it turned out to be terrible. So... that's why I'm speaking to trusted friends like you about this to, you know, find out what
I think what they did wrong with the RT is instead of building a tablet for people who want a tablet, they tried to build a tablet and throw Windows on it on an ARM-based platform.
Yeah. The other problem is they never supported it. You know, it didn't get an update after 2 years. Also, my keyboard, you know, my Alcantara keyboard or whatever I bought for it, which was a separate purchase. It has life on it now. I should take some pictures and maybe I should do a time lapse because there's stuff growing on. There's like mold or something. you know, and so I don't want to throw it away because I feel like I would be, you know, killing something. but there is an e-waste. I should note the RT still works. Unlike my Surface Pros, which all died, my Surface RT still boots. The batteries, you know, of course, it's over 10 years old now, 2012, so it's 12 years old.
Oh, yeah.
But if I plug in the god-awful adapter on it with that awful magnetic, because there was no USB-C option to power it, it'll still boot. That reminds me, the Surface Pro has, people seem to like it, but I don't like the idea of this magnetic, that rectangular thing. But it also can be powered via USB-C, correct?
Yes. Yes, okay. As a matter of fact, it's got the Surface connector. That's what they call it. It's the the narrow little thing.
Yeah,
it's this thing,
right?
But that's pretty useful actually, because that's how you can attach all of, you know, Microsoft's got docks and stuff that attach that way. And when I do attach a dock with that or charge it with that, I still have two USB-Cs, which until my current Air, which has the MagSafe connector on it again.
Yeah.
You know, if you got an Air, you got two USB-Cs, that was it. You charged it, that was one of them.
Yeah, which is why I have a series of hubs.
But I did actually, I was playing with this thing down where I normally sit, and I have a Surface Go 3.
The problem I had with the Surface connector on the RT, by the way, I feel like I have to spit every time I say the name, but I'll avoid doing that. is that it never, even when it was new, it never quite lined up 100% of the time. I always had to kind of wiggle it and, you know, before it actually would charge.
I've never had that problem. Mine have always, I get it close and it snaps in and it goes. So
yeah, well, again, this was, I think, the first Surface with that connector. So
that might be the Hawaii. It might be the humidity out there or something.
It was like that when it's brand new out of the box. And it was winter, so it wasn't very humid when I got it.
Knew it was going to Hawaii.
I got it December 2012. I remember it vividly. And I was really up on it. In fact, I'll be honest, if you go back, I think Information Week still has an archive of my review of it. And I was quite pleased with the concept, I think. I was more pleased with the concept than the actual thing, which soured on me over the months to follow. But I was really high on that. I thought it was like, this is something that could happen. It's better than a netbook in theory, right?
See, that's why you don't get high on anything other than drugs.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Technology will always let you down. It will always lead you down a path that will, but you know, drugs, they're more reliable. Sometimes they're cheaper depending on, you know, where you get them.
Well, I think
they're generally less regulated, you know.
Amongst our friends, I think we have had several discussions over the years, especially when we used to get together in person, that, you know, our habit is way more expensive than some drug habits.
Sometimes you think so, yeah.
But at any rate. Okay, and I think I did, and I know the answer to this already, but I know you have not yet tried the DJI Osmo Pocket 3 software on it, but I'm really curious
how it works out
when you do, or if it runs at all.
Yeah, you know, I'm not sure I'd use it much, you know, because I use the software that's on the phone or whatever to run the Osmo. But I think for the videos, I just bring them into something else that does videos. Got well. It.
Okay.
I don't do that much with it anyway. You know.
Yeah.
I take for the video and that's what I get.
It would be more critical. Is one of the things, you know, instead of the DJI Osmo Pocket 3, I bought the Insta360 X4, which does, you know, kind of a sphere, records a sphere around you at all times. And one of the things I learned that, you know, I should have occurred to me before I bought it, but one of the things I learned after the fact when I actually started working the video is when you work on these sphere videos, the important thing is not how you take the picture, because it's taking a picture of everything. The important thing is how you edit that, the focus of what you're actually looking at in the video, how you choose, you know, you become like a videographer, how you choose what to focus on. And so I'm highly dependent on its software to sort of pre-process the video in that sense. And so what I usually do is what I always do is I have to bring it into the software from Insta360. You know, choose what I'm focusing on and how I'm moving around in the video over time. And then once I finish that, I'll bring it into, you know, iMovie on an Apple or what's that thing on the Windows? It's actually pretty good. ClipChamp, which is actually pretty good. I actually like that.
Yeah.
To, you know, put titles and things like that on. So I'm just going to avoid running to Costco right after we speak. But
do look closely. Well, I know you're not looking at a Surface anyway, but do look and see what processor that has on that.
No,
I think the Costco one had the not the Elite, but the Plus, I think.
Yeah. We'll talk about that in a minute because I. But anyway, that's pretty. There is, I have an article that I linked earlier in the show notes from, who is it? It was from a pretty trusted source. Oh, it's Tom's Hardware. And I think they're pretty good. So Tom's Hardware, some other folks have articles about some of the software that doesn't run well or doesn't run at all. I think Adobe may have issued some kind of news statement that some of their products do not run on the Samsung Copilot Plus PC, for example. I don't know why they just chose Samsung, but there's that. Okay. And I guess that's about. Oh, here it is. Here it is. It's Tom's Guide. Sorry, not Tom's, which is, I think, the same. But the compatibility notice, first reported by Wall Street Journal, states that many security programs, various Adobe software, and even apps like Google Drive won't currently run on Samsung's new Copilot PC. It doesn't mention any other brand, so I don't know if it's specific. Oh, but
that sounds odd. I'm not terribly worried about the security software, I'm happy with what Microsoft has done for me over the years for nothing. I don't need to get some prior KGB guy to do my software for me. So,
I have been using more PC Mac software for a while. I was just doing everything on my iPad. Or not everything, but many things on my iPad. But, having gotten the new camera, the Insta360 X4, one thing I found out, by the way, is it's way easier to use either the Windows or Mac OS version of the Insta360 editor than even an iPad, which isn't great, which is still good, but it's just way easier to me to work on them. Seems like they have more features or the UI is easier to understand or something, but I just like it, which is sad because the fastest computer in my home right now is the M4 iPad Pro. So anytime I move to a desktop or laptop, I'm stepping down in processing power, which is fine. Okay. And there is one more article. PC World says most apps work on Copilot PCs without a fuss. There are a few exceptions, which is, kind of rehashes what Tom's Hardware and I guess the New York
every time you get a new PC or a new OS, there's issues with some things.
Well, this one in particular, though, right? Because we're shifting from the x86, Intel AMD to ARM, and of course our RT was just a disaster because nothing ran on it.
Ran on it.
Not well. It came with like IE4 or something, but or six, whatever it was.
A long time ago.
Yeah, it couldn't have been four. All right, so that's about it. Okay, so now let me tell you my story. So you and John and my other buddy Sterling, the three of you, terrible people. Also Paul Lawler, the four of you are terrible people. So you guys always come to me like, oh, I got this really cool thing, and I go, oh, I don't really need, oh, it is kind of cool. So I was looking at a number of non-Microsoft Copilot Plus PC options. Dell XPS 13 looked really interesting. Acer and Asus had a couple of interesting things. So, I was thinking, with all my horrible experiences with the Surface Pro, I'm not going to get another Surface. But then I looked at your config and go, that's too expensive. I can't afford that. But as you said, Costco's bundles are pretty interesting. And so I was going to get the low-end bundle. I forget what it's called. Well, it's not really a bundle, low-end machine, which is the standard clamshell Surface, Microsoft Surface Copilot Plus PC. But then I looked at the what is it called? I thought I posted it here, but perchance I did not. Oh, here it is. I did put it in our show notes. Costco has something called the Microsoft Surface Pro Copilot Plus PC Bundle. And at first I said, I don't understand the difference because there's a 13-inch Surface Copilot Plus PC, and there's like a 13.5-inch, and the 13-inch is more expensive. And what I noticed was the 13-inch version is, well, first of all, it's a much higher resolution display. Both got the same amount of RAM, 16 gigs, same amount of SSD, 1 terabyte. But this one, the 13-inch is also the 2-in-1. So the keyboard snaps off like yours. But the bundle includes the keyboard and includes a Surface Pen.
But it probably doesn't include the Flex keyboard.
Yeah. But it includes a keyboard.
So, yeah, and the difference between the Flex and the one right below that is that the Flex you can take off and use it remotely.
That's the big difference. This one has to be connected to
this one. That one would have to be connected. Now you could fold it completely back underneath.
Uh huh. Or just take it off and use it as a tablet.
Or just take it off.
Yeah. Like my Surface RT and my Surface Pro 4.
Yeah, I mean, they've always been able to completely pull off.
And it's not the Elite, it's the Plus, so it's not as snappy as yours, but it's also not as expensive as yours. I think it's $1,599. In fact, I still have the tab up here. Yeah, $1,600 essentially. But it includes a keyboard, includes a Surface Pen. It's got a lot of SSD at 1 terabyte. I think the Copilot Plus PC started at 256 generally. So, it's a little bit extra.
Yeah.
So with the
Surface, you get that nice thing. So you can actually take it. Lay that thing way down like that. So if you're drawing.
Yeah. I'm really tempted, especially because it comes with a Surface Pen and it is a 2-in-1. So I have other devices that fold over and they're just not comfortable to doodle on when they're folded over. They're just
if you still got an old Surface Pen, that'll work on it too.
No, I do not. All the Surface Pens I had were work pens and I returned everything when I retired. So. Actually, so here's a funny thing. I told you that after my third Surface Pro 4 blew up, I replaced it with a Lenovo, and this is years ago. I kept the Surface Pen because it worked fine as a PowerPoint clicker with the Lenovo. You obviously can't draw on it, but as a clicker.
It's interesting. They do have it's a Microsoft Pen protocol to do the writing, but the clicker part is Bluetooth.
Yeah.
So if you pair it, it'll do whatever it wants.
It was great. It was truly great as a presentation tool pre-pandemic when we still did presentations. So this tells you how long ago this all happened. This was like 2019. It's 5 years ago. That's a long time ago. So anyway, that's what I'm looking at. $1,600 plus tax. Oh, Costco, by the way, in addition to upping the storage and including the pen, the keyboard, blah, blah, blah. They also, I think the Surface, most laptops come with 1 year of warranty, and this price includes a second year warranty. So, two-year warranty. Yeah. So, and it says in warehouse pickup on the webpage. So, and I live a mile and a half from Costco. Given my luck with the world, I'll go there all excited and they won't have any. So, which is probably for the best. Yeah, I don't need to spend more money.
Probably for the best, yeah.
All right.
I think about this for you because I know you do enough drawing and stuff like that. It would be an interesting thing for you to try with a Microsoft Pen rather than
the Surface Pen or whatever they call it. I am looking forward to it, especially since I bought the Affinity bundle, which includes Windows licensing for Affinity Designer. And if that's the other question, will it run on in the Prism emulation mode? So that'll be an interesting question. But what if it runs and it's got a Surface Pen?
I'm pretty sure that I'm just going to go ahead and buy that thing for like $52 or whatever it was. I think it was. It's worth it for the three different platforms
programs. $70. Oh, I bought it already. I bought it.
Yeah, I know, but I mean, I might do it. Yeah. I'll let you know if it runs.
Oh, thing. Oh yeah, thank you. That'd be great.
Yeah. So if I do, so yeah. I'll definitely ping you and say, hey, it works.
Yeah. I'm thinking about it. Yuck. Okay, I'm gonna think about it. I see my post Father's Day gift to myself, since my dad has passed away and my father-in-law has passed away. I've got no other dad to buy for except me.
Except you. That's how it works for dads, you know. Like last weekend, right, when they, you know, what was it? Somebody said, I don't remember who it was. It says, sure, we can do this on Father's Day. It's not like it's important like Mother's Day.
I forget who said. Might have been Don. Yeah, there's a routine. I forget the name of the comedian. I saw him on, it showed up in my YouTube feed last week on Father's Day. And his deal was, he says, you know, Father's Day is the 20 on the list of most celebrated, you know, holidays. It's not really like a vacation holiday, but holidays. Yeah. It was number one is Christmas. Number two is Mother's Day. So you are competing against Jesus and your mom.
Your mom.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You are not competitive as a dad at all. But anywho. All right. Thanks, Sven. Thanks, John. John, I kind of dominated the questions, but.
Well, I'm just trying to save as much money as possible before a vacation later this summer and potentially buying new computers. So I am intentionally trying to distance myself.
I hear you, and I don't blame you. If I were as smart as you, Dr. Westfall, I also would distance myself from this. But sadly, I am not, and so here we are. All righty, MobileViews Podcast 516. Thank you so much to, of course, the good Dr. Jon Westfall, but especially to Mr. Johansson for being a terrible, terrible friend for many years now. and I think the next time I go to Costco, I'm not going to rush out. I'm not going to rush out. I'm going to think about this. Next time I go to Costco, I am going to look for it. If it's there, I'll buy it. If it's not there, I will go home sadder, but not as poor. So we'll talk to you next time.